you're back. Can you believe it?
We're back.
Hi, hello, hello, hello. Hi, chat. What's up? What's going on? Sorry, we're a bit late. We're talking a lot, but please welcome Misha.
Yes, welcome me.
Welcome Misha Mansour from Periphery. You've seen Misha before.
My first time on Twitch ever.
Yeah.
Actually, I'm not from Periphery anymore. I'm more from Twitch at this point. Are you from Dragon Force anymore? You're on this thing way more. This is your job now. Yeah, Dragon Force is just your side project. Right?
Yeah. They say I'm a YouTuber now.
Yeah, you are a YouTuber. You're a YouTube influencer. You know, that was your dream. When you were like 10 years old, playing guitar, it's like, someday I'm going to be a YouTube influencer.
Yeah, part-time Dragon Force guitar player.
Part-time rock star. You know, when it's convenient and not dangerous, I'm a rock star. That's the time I'm an influencer.
It's definitely a difficult time for musicians and bands out there that, you know, we okay, you know, okay, we lost a lot of money, but, you know, we've been saving and trying to be smart. But I kind of like, you kind of mentioned this in the press before, like you try to kind of teach people, right, about how music business is and how money works. So, you know, it's a bit controversial, right, when you said this thing. Maybe we don't talk too much about it, but
I don't care anymore,
yeah,
whatever, fuck it.
I always like your opinion because I think it's important for the young musicians out there.
Yeah, that's why I talk about it, because I feel like it's important. I think two things that happens is I crush some dreams and I tell people things they don't want to hear. You know, it's like I tell them about realities that you know are true. You know everything I'm saying is true. You're like, yeah, that's just the way it is. But like, there's a lot of people who are hopeful who are like, you know, I want to be a rock star. I want to play music and make money. I don't even need to make that much money. I need to make like $50,000-$60,000 a year just being in a band. I'm like, dude, good luck. You know, like, that's hard. That's really fucking hard. It's hard to make any money in that, and they just don't want to hear it.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm only doing it because I think, you know, you and I were very similar when it comes to money and business and all. It's like, be prepared. I'd rather know the bad news up front rather than like pretend like it doesn't exist and be faced with it later, you know, because then you can prepare for it, right? And this is a good example. It's like, you're Twitch streaming right now. Despite the fact that like you can't tour, you got creative and you can make a living and you're making the most. You adapt to the bad situations rather than like sort of like, well, you know, this sucks. Like, what do I do? But it's because you understand like this music thing, you do it for fun, man. Like, you know, if you make money, great. If you don't, you never should have expected to make it, you know?
And it's more difficult since the places like the streaming services, right, that pay musicians very little while they're absolutely loaded, you know, how much is company worth? What, I mean, and like you said it before, you know, all this is difficult to be playing in a band and making music. So what's, you know, how do you feel like people should approach it these days? I mean, what, you know, it's almost like it has to be a hobby.
Yeah, I think to some degree, like always treat it like a little bit of a hobby. Like, and if it can morph into a business someday, it can. But here's a good example. It's like, you never thought you'd be streaming on Twitch. But in a way, it's way more lucrative and way more possible right now than Dragon Force. Dragon Force is just an idea right now. It streams on Spotify, but you're not playing shows anytime soon, right? So that can just be its thing, and you can work on it, you can write songs or whatever. But really, this is where you're investing your time, you know? So you pivoted. You didn't get too stubborn with the idea of like, no, I said I was going to be a rock god, therefore I'm going to continue at, you know, just be a rock god sitting at home doing nothing. So I think, because you frame it as like, this is a hobby, or this is one of the things that I do, it makes it okay to chase other things. But I think when people get too stubborn with it, like, no, like, I haven't made it, and I'm not professional until, like, I'm only making my money, or making most of my money from the band, like, you limit yourself to other opportunities. In the end, I've turned into probably more of a businessman who plays music for fun, rather, but I never wanted to be a businessman. Like, that doesn't sound sexy. Like, that's really boring, actually, you know? But it turns out I found a way to make it fun. Like, I do stuff that I like. So it's, and I genuinely enjoy it. You know, it's something that brings me a lot of happiness. I never thought it would. If you told me that's what you're going to be, I'd have been like, wow, I'm disappointed. I failed. I never made it, you know?
Yeah, you have to enjoy what you're doing, right? So we played the guitar because we enjoy doing it.
Yeah.
We did the band because we enjoy doing it.
Yeah.
I did streaming 2.5 years ago because I was having fun, just like being doing this little
best reason fun thing. To do something. Yeah.
Even YouTube, I'm having fun doing silly trolls videos videos that, you know.
That's the key is you want to do something. A lot of people try to do things so they'll see what you're doing. They're like, oh, well, I got to do Twitch too. And they'll hate it. But they're like, well, Herman's doing it and he's doing well. If you don't enjoy it, you're not going to do well. You got to do things that you genuinely enjoy. But that's what you have to find. That's where you find it out for yourself. Mm-hmm. So you see, like, what are the things that I like? And what are the things I like that are adjacent to the things that I like that I could enjoy? And you just kind of feel around. And eventually, like, something will come through. And maybe several things will. And you just kind of prioritize. And I think, you know, I learned this from Matt in my band, right? Like, Matt is very good at sort of knowing when to cut his losses and move on. Mm-hmm. And that can be a very tough thing. You have a lot of time invested into an idea or something. You know, he did that with a company that was his baby called Band Happy. I don't know if you remember that thing or if you were ever part of it, but it was like a lesson platform. Mm-hmm. And it just, you know, after a certain point, it was doing well, but it was more work than it was worth putting in. The cost benefit wasn't worthwhile. And he walked away from it, you know? And I think that was a really good call. It's a very difficult thing to do when you are so invested. With like 6 or 7 years of his life, if not more, and gave it everything he had, you know? Mm-hmm. But the strength to be able to take a moment and look at it and be like, you know what? It's time to call it. It's time to stop wasting time. Time to stop focusing on the sunk cost and looking forward. And as soon as he was done with that, it freed him up to like start all these other things. And, you know, we do GGD together. That would never have happened if it wasn't for him stopping that. And that's very successful. So it's like you have to give yourself the opportunities and be honest with yourself and like know when it's time to move on. Like, yes, that was a great idea and it didn't quite work, so I'm going to do this other thing. And that's why for me, Peripheries just become a hobby, you know. Whatever money I make from it, great, you know. But like, it's kind of nice to not have that stress and to have my main income be from like the businesses and the other stuff and the signature stuff and whatever, because it allows the music to be sort of just purely this fun thing I do with my friends, you know? Mm-hmm. And I'm sure it's the same thing for you right now. We're like, Dragon Force can just be this thing you do because it's fun to do. It's why you started it, you know?
So this is interesting, actually, because I, you know, there's not many musicians I had here that run multiple businesses. You have your pedal stuff, you have your software, of course, you have your signature products going on. So do you feel like in some way, well, Peripheries, sometimes you might have to say, I'm just going to pack it up because, like you said, you don't make enough money from Peripheries.
Well, I would if that's what I was doing it for, but I do it because I enjoy it. So, yeah, if I was looking at like income streams, I mean, actually, we're doing well now. We own our label and we own all our music. So we're actually doing, like, as a band, we're making good money now for a change. But, yeah, that's like 10 years in, you know, took a decade for that to happen, and owning our own label and, you know, making sure that we didn't sell our masters to anyone. Like, because we own all our music, that really helps us a lot. But if that wasn't the case and I just was doing it for money, I probably would have thrown in the towel a while ago.
But now you're doing it as a hobby, so it's
just for fun. Better, right? I don't care how much money we make, and it's kind of freeing. It's like when we make albums, you know. It's just like, no, let's just make whatever we want, you know? And we always wrote for ourselves, but maybe there's something in the back of your mind, you know, subconsciously that's like, you know, oh, this has to be good. I don't even care if our albums are good. I just want them to be fun. I want to have fun with my friends, you know? And people seem to like it, you know, that we had the sort of loosest attitude on the last album. Where it was just the best experience. Just felt like I was fucking around with my friends, you know? And then we had an album, and then those songs do really well live, and like that album cycle was great until COVID killed it. So
so I do want to ask you in this, because, and I think we should explain, I don't know about your feeling, but I feel like in a band, the most difficult thing, probably the second most difficult thing, or maybe the first one, business or this, is the relationship with the band members, right? That's a very difficult thing to manage, to keep it as for many, many years, especially if you're living with each other on tour. So do you think, in a way, I mean, because I don't know what your other guys are, you know, you obviously the business guy here, you got a lot of things going, but they don't have the same type of business setup, do they? Like,
some of them do. Like Matt probably is even more business oriented than I am. Mm-hmm. You know, And he's more like an operator type. So, yeah, he's very heavy on that stuff.
Do you feel like they, you know, do you feel like a band member that doesn't do business, like outside, might try to push the band in a different direction? Do you ever feel like that might happen?
You know, I'd say we've been pretty fortunate. You know, like, because, for example, Spencer, our singer, we've tried to push him in a more entrepreneurial way, but he also just doesn't care. He lives a very simple life, you know, like, he doesn't care about money. I mean, in a way, I envy him because he's just a happy dude. Like, it doesn't take very much for him to be happy. He just wants to feel like he's doing good work and having fun, you know, and he makes enough to get by. So he's in as much as like, he doesn't make as much, the opportunities are there, but he doesn't really care about taking them because he's like, I'm doing all right. I've got what I need. So, we're the kind of culture in the band where if anyone came to us and if Spencer was like, hey, I'd like to get into more of this stuff, he'd have the whole band's worth of people to tell him what he could do and give him ideas and work with him and help him out. We would. You know, Jake's got his signature models, but doesn't have really like any business on the side. Like, and Mark's like a bit more business oriented, but like, again, it's generally the signature stuff, but they're happy. They have everything they need, you know, they do well for themselves. And I'd say like Matt and I are the ones who are like very sort of like more serial entrepreneur kind of like, oh, where can we go? Cause like, you know, I just invested in a coffee business. I love coffee. So like, it's just anything that we're passionate about. We're like, okay, well, how can we turn this into like some kind of moneymaker, I guess, because we understand that the tie between like being genuinely interested in something and if there's an angle to make money off of it, it can bring you a lot of happiness, you know? I'll tell you guys something like very, very true. It's like, I think the saddest I've been, ironically, and the least fulfilled I've been with the band is when it was the most like a job, when it was sort of something I relied on the most for money. I didn't like that dynamic. I got into it purely out of passion and, you know, with dreams of like, you know, being a band, whatever. But then you get sucked into the machine of the industry, and it's an ugly machine, and it's filled with people who want to take advantage of you and want a piece of you, and trying to just get your team to the point where it's not those people. And I almost quit. I almost quit touring. You know, I was so just burnt out and so over it. I just felt like there was no end in sight. And it just became this thing that I was like, this is not why I got into music. I didn't get into music care that we get on this tour so that we could go on that tour so that we can do that. Like, that's not music to me. Like, I don't care about that stuff. I just wanted to make music that could. And it was really just an exciting thing. And turning it back into a hobby was the best thing I ever did. So it's really ironic because if people, I understand why you're like, oh, I could make a living doing the thing I love. I'll tell you, be careful. You might ruin the thing you love. And it's kind of like that with cars right now. Like, part of me is like tempted, like, oh, should I get a YouTube channel going? Should I become a reviewer? Should I try to get press cars? Should I do it? And I could see a path to that. There's work I could do and there's things I could do to make it happen. But the other part of my brain's like, I might ruin cars for me. If it becomes a job, and I have friends who are there and they're like, sometimes they're like, oh, yeah, I got like 5 press cars I got to review. And in my mind, I'm like, that's so cool. But they're burnt out. They're like, one of my friends is like a journalist. I was like, when are we going for a drive? Let's go for a drive. He's like, dude, I have to drive every weekend. He's like, I'm not driving for fun. I'm not driving for fun right now. And like, to me, like, that would be such a bummer. So there's always a cost, and you have to consider what that cost is. In the case of cars, the cost is money. I could trade that cost of money for stress or, you know, for love of something. And I think I'm going to be very careful with cars. Because my mind always tends to go in that direction where it's like, well, how can I save money on this? How can I get a better deal on this? But I don't think that cost is necessarily worth my passion for it. And that's why we came full circle with Periphery. And that's why I'm going to be very careful with any of my hobbies, not to get too deep into that money side. So it doesn't mess it up for me, you know?